living home. Your presence, Lord, I've tasted and seen how the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the
where you are at Sunday morning. God is real. And the Holy Spirit is with us. He inhabits the praise of His people.
Let us become more aware of Your presence. Let us experience the glory of Your goodness. Let us become more aware of Your presence. Let us experience the glory of Your goodness. Holy Spirit, You are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory
Father, we thank you for loving us. We thank you for allowing us to worship. Scattered all over our community, your people are worshiping you, singing praise to you, thanking you for who you are, thanking you for mothers. Thank you for the institution of family, the way that you wove it all together. God, we love you. We thank you for allowing us to worship you this morning. In Christ's name, amen. Welcome to our service. Welcome to our worship time. One more week. Next week, we'll be all here in God's house. But it doesn't, this week, we get to worship him. We get to thank him. We get to praise him. Wherever you are driving down the road, however you're listening, God is God and God is with us. He inhabits the praise of his people. This is Mother's Day weekend. And we can all tell stories, but as I was thinking about Mother's Day and trying to plan a worship time, that thought about that, I kept thinking about grace. There's nothing quite like the grace of a Christian lady. And that grace comes from God. And I'm thankful for that. So I'm thankful for the grace that he had for me. I'm thankful for the grace that my mothers and my grandmothers showed to me. Even though Mama, sometimes she would get mad as fire at my cousins, she always had that grace. My wife shows it to our boys. People in our church and our extended family show it. Nothing like the grace of a godly woman. And that grace comes from God. It's the amazing grace from God. Let's continue worshiping. This is Amazing Grace.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? His love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Conquered the grave.
amazing grace. And I'm so glad that in my sin, that Jesus lifted me.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. I was sinking down. Jesus lifted me. I was sinking down. Jesus lifted me. I was sinking down. Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound.
I'm thankful for that this morning. One of the greatest praise and worship songs ever penned that we've ever had the opportunity to sing is this next one.
Thank you, Scott. Praise team. Appreciate those behind the scene running the camera and the sound in this technological savvy age. I'm glad we have those folks that can think that way. And good morning. Welcome. Whether you're listening through our Zoom conference call, whether you're watching Facebook Live, or whether you are sometime in the future watching this on our YouTube channel, we're so glad that you're with us this morning, and happy Mother's Day. Mother's Day is a wonderful day in the life of our church, and we look forward to that every year. Normally on Mother's Day, we are packed out. Everybody's dressed up. It's kind of like Easter all over again, but this year it's a little different, but I'm excited, and if you'll hang on till the end of the sermon, I want to share with you some things about what's going to happen next week. As Scott has already alluded to, next week we're going to be back together again here in our own sanctuary, and it's going to be a little different, but it's going to be good. We're going to be able to worship together. So I'll share some of those things with you as we when we get to the end of the service. Today, if you have your Bibles, wherever you are, let me encourage you to open to Proverbs 31. Proverbs 31, and we'll begin in verse 10, and this is a wonderful chapter, a passage of Scripture that is used many times, but on Mother's Day especially, as we focus in on the women in our lives. Today we're going to celebrate all women, but especially those who are mothers. Proverbs 31, and we'll begin in verse 10, and let me encourage you, whether it's just you or you're gathered as a family, if you're scattered throughout your house, let me encourage you to bring everybody together in one room and shut off all the phones and everything, and just for a few moments, Let's focus in on God's Word and go from there. Now, I'll read the passage of Scripture. I'll kind of break it down because it's a long passage. I'll break it down as we go through the message this morning. But I want to start off by some mom quotes. There are things that I can remember my mom saying that she said many times to me. I call them mom quotes, and I'm sure that you have some from your mother. But here's a few that I read doing a little bit of research. Listen to this one. This is unknown. We don't know who said this. Life doesn't come with a manual. It comes with a mother. Life doesn't come with a manual. It comes with a mother. How true that is. Abraham Lincoln, and if you've read anything about Abraham Lincoln, he loved his mom. He was very, very emotionally attached to his mother. And he said this, "All that I am or hope to be, I owe to my angel mother." I imagine most of us, if not all of us, can certainly relate to our angel mothers. And then another unknown, "If at first you don't succeed, try doing it the way mom told you to in the first place." Well, you know, there is a lot of truth in that. And then finally, again, another unknown, "An ounce of mother is worth a pound of clergy." An ounce of mother is worth a pound of clergy. How true that is. Let's go to the Lord in prayer as we get started this morning. Father God, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you that we will soon be able to come back together and worship you as a body of believers called First Baptist Church, Nashville, Georgia. We look forward to next week. But Lord, today we celebrate our mothers. In fact, we celebrate all of our women. They play such an important role in our lives, and we're thankful for them, and we want to bless them, honor them, lift them up today. But Lord, most of all, we want to honor and lift you up as the King of Kings, as the Lord of Lords. And Lord, we pray that everything that we say and do will bring honor and glory to you today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now in the passage, Proverbs 31, and again we're going to begin in verse 10, but there is a key verse in that passage, and that verse is the 23rd verse. Let me read that to you, just kind of a little sneak peek of where we're going. It says, "Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land." In other words, he's talking about this is a successful man. And one of the reasons that this is a successful man is this kind of wife is the kind of wife that a man needs to be a successful man. That's what Proverbs 31 talks about, is the kind of godly woman that we should aspire to, and certainly for us men, the kind of godly woman that we would want to marry, because it lifts us up. So this morning, as we look at Proverbs 31, I want to look at five areas of an excellent woman. Five areas of an excellent woman. First of all, her marriage. Her marriage. Look there at verses 10 through 12. "An excellent wife, who can find? For her worth is far above jewels." Men, let me just tell you something. If your wife's sitting there next to you this morning, that's a good place to say amen. "For her worth is far above jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life." The word there, excellent, or your version may say virtuous. It means strong in all moral qualities. Folks, if we need anything today, we need to strengthen, and this is men and women, we need to strengthen our moral qualities. We live in a fallen world, sin-filled, that is depraved. But yet God is saying that we need to lift up and live according to His Word and live a life above what the world has. It talks about how she is hard to find. A godly woman is hard to find. I encourage our young people who are single that as they go through dating, that they don't settle just to have a relationship, just to get married, but that they will continue to be patient and pray and ask God to bring them a godly woman or a godly man into their life. It says that she is priceless, even above the price of jewels. She is trustworthy and devoted. One of the things that I just love about being married is having someone that to go through life with together, to have companionship, and someone who is as devoted to me as I am to her, and I'm thankful to have that in my wife. But she, this Proverbs 31 woman, enhances his reputation. Amen. All right, men, this is another place where you can say amen to your wives, because our wives so often enhance our reputation. I know that certainly is true for me. But not only her marriage, but Proverbs 31 also talks about her behavior. Her behavior, you know, we've looked at 1 John, we've looked at other passages of Scripture that talks about the behavior of Christians, how we're to live our lives day in and day out to honor God and to be a witness to others. And here in verses 13 through 24, it talks about her behavior. Look there at verse 13. She looks for wool and flax and works with her hands in delight. She is like merchant ships. She brings her food from afar. She rises also while it is still night and gives food to her household and portions to her maidens. She considers a field and buys it. From her earnings, she plants a vineyard. She girds herself with strength and makes her arms strong. See, she senses that her gain is good. Her lamp does not go out at night. Verse 19, she stretches out her hands to the distaff, and her hands grasp the spindle. She extends her hands to the poor, and she stretches out her hands to the needy. She's not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. She makes coverings for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them and supplies belts to the tradesmen. Now, let's just be honest. Some of that language we don't use today. But if you go back and do a little bit digging, let me help sum up what that passage we just read says about the Proverbs 31 woman. First of all, she's a hard worker. She's a hard worker. By the way, whether man or woman, there is no place in God's economy for laziness. No place. And here it even elevates the fact that this precious lady is a hard worker. Talks about how she is wise. She is wise with her household and all the things that she manages. She's a planner. A planner. She is able to think into the future and plan ahead and make the preparations that are needed. And then in verse 20, let me read verse 20 again. She extends her hand to the poor. She stretches out her hands to the needy. She thinks of others. You see, her mind is not on herself. And can we just be honest? We live in a very selfish world today where it's all about me. But not so with the Proverbs 31 woman. She's thinking not only about her husband and her family, but even outside of her family, she is thinking about others. To sum up this passage, it's clear that she takes care of her household. She takes care of her household, her husband, her children, and others. Well, the third thing I want you to see about the Proverbs 31 woman is her character. Her character. Remember, our character is who we are when nobody else is around. Let me say that again. Our character is who we are when no one else is around. It's not what we are on Sunday morning when we're surrounded by church folks. It's not what we are anywhere else, but it's when it is how we really are, how we really think, how we really act. Verse 25. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she smiles at the future. She opens her mouth in, listen to these words used, she opens her mouth in wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Again, speaking to, this is a woman that is a hard worker. She is not lazy. But look at those words, wisdom, kindness, not one for idleness. These words describe the character of the woman who fears the Lord. And see, that's what ultimately sets the Proverbs 31 woman apart, is not that she's this perfect model, but the fact that she fears the Lord. She loves the Lord. Number four, look at her family life. Her family life. Look there at verse 28. Her children rise up and bless her. Her husband also, and he praises her, saying, many daughters have done nobly, but you excel them all. She has greatly respected. She was greatly respected because she has earned the praise of her family. Today is the day that we have set aside to praise our wives and our mothers and those special ladies in our life. They deserve that praise. But look at what it says about her children in verse 28, the very beginning there. It says, her children rise up and bless her. Or your version may say, call her blessed. That's important. John MacArthur, he says this, there can be no higher joy for a mother than for her children to grow up to praise her as the source of the wisdom that made them godly. And oh, that's so true about my mom and my mom in love and certainly my wife. But also it speaks to her husband. There in verses 28 and 29, it talks about her husband praises her. Her husband praises her. Talks about how his wife excels above all the others. And you know what, men? That's how it should be. Not just one day a year, but we should praise our wives any opportunity we get. We should be saying, yes, she's the best one out there. That should be certainly the attitude that we carry in our hearts towards our wives, our spouses. And then number five, and this really is where it all comes down to. This is the most important thing for any mother, any wife, any woman, and for any man to be fair. Her spiritual life. Her spiritual life. Look there in verses 30 and 31. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord, she will be praised. Give her the product of her hands and let her works praise her in the gates. The key divining virtue of the Proverbs 31 woman, the godly woman, is a woman who fears the Lord. A woman who fears the Lord. And by the way, that's where every one of us should be. We should be a person who fears the Lord. Not the kind of fear that we're worried about God zapping us if we mess up, but a reverential fear. The kind of fear that a holy God deserves and demands. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. That's the kind of fear that we're talking about. Psalms chapter 1, verse 2, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. One of the things that when we fear the Lord is that we have a desire to know him better, and the way that we know him better is through his word. Are we spending time in his word getting to know our heavenly Father? The most important issue for any woman, and by the way, any man, is to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Everything else, now listen to me, parents especially, grandparents as well, everything else must be second. That includes our children, our grandchildren, even our spouses. Everything else must be second. The Lord Jesus Christ must be first, because if he is first in our life, we'll be a better husband, a better wife, a better parent, a better grandparent, hands down. Well, let me close with this. Some of you might read Proverbs 31 and say, there is no way I can live up to all of that. And you know you're right. You and I, we can't live up to that. Apart from Jesus Christ, nobody can. But through a relationship with Jesus Christ, as he justifies us, as he gives us his righteousness, as he empowers us with the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, then we are able to live the life that God has called us to live. And we can look at Proverbs 31 as a wonderful example, a target for us to attempt to attain while we live here on this earth. I encourage you today, remember Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. Honor your father and your mother. Honor your father and your mother. Well, I pray that you have a wonderful Mother's Day. I pray that the Lord blesses you today. And before I pray and dismiss us, let me just share a little bit about next week. These are not all the details. You'll be getting those the beginning of this week. Next Sunday will be our first service back together since the COVID-19, all that stuff came up, and we've had to just do the virtual services. Next Sunday, there'll be two services. There'll be an 8:30 and 11 o'clock service, and we'll have kind of some special setups when you come in here, but understand there'll be no Sunday school. There'll be no Sunday evening service. There'll be no nursery or no children's church. I know that's a lot of no's right now, but we're going to slowly work our way back into a full schedule like we were before COVID-19. We're just going to be smart, patient as we work and watch the numbers and see how things develop in our state and our community. But we're going to ask you when you come in, doors will be open 15 minutes before, so don't get here too early. We'll have the pews set up where you'll see, but we're going to ask you to sit by families every other pew. And that's one of the reasons we're going to two services, to make sure that we have plenty of room with the two services. I believe that we'll be able to do that pretty easily. But for kind of the final information, look for a flock note that'll go out by Wednesday. Also, my video this Wednesday, instead of kind of our normal virtual prayer meeting, it will be a message from me to you, just kind of going into some more details about what next Sunday will entail. Listen, I am so excited for us to get back together. I've been looking forward to that. I've been praying for that. I've missed you so much. And so until next Sunday, I pray that you have a wonderful, wonderful week. Let me pray, and then we'll see you next week. Lord Jesus, we thank you for today. We thank you for our mothers. We thank you for all the ladies in our church. We celebrate them today. We ask your blessings on them and their families. And Lord, as we leave this place today, we, with excited anticipation, look forward to next Sunday when we'll be able to gather back together in a little different way, but yet, Lord, we'll be together again and be able to worship you. And Lord Jesus, we love you. Thank you for how you first loved us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Goodbye.